All right. Hi, everybody. It's always good to be back here in sitting and stuff. So thank you for inviting me again. People have asked if I would do this How Not to Suck at Pinball presentation again. So, here I am. Question first. Anybody with pinballs at home that's not playing in there? Nobody? You disappoint me. Come on. Yeah. So, no, okay, fine. Anyway, who sucks at it or thinks that he or she sucks? Welcome. If you turn the camera, you will see the audience go, hi, it's me. So first of all, who am I? My name is Peter. I do IT project management and a boring thing. I sell cables for retro gaming consoles. I am on Twitter and I have some machines at home that I can practice on. Millionaire Xenon, a Black Knight, one that switched on, not that one. F-14 Tomcat, a Pinbot, a Whirlwind, a Robocop, and a Firepower that I need to get restored. And because we are now bragging, my Robocop is signed by Peter Weller, the actor who plays Robocop in all the movies. So fuck you all. There are some things, consoler cables I mentioned. I'm also active in the demo scene for Revision Demo Party, and I also do radio stuff for Scene Set, and also some demo scene related and gaming related YouTube stuff with other people. So we have over 100 slides, but I have a question. That the first pack of slides is some history of pinball, where it came from, what it got started. If you all yell nobody cares, I will skip them. So you do we watch them or do we skip them? Watch them? Okay, good, we'll watch them. Be prepared for the next 106 slides to go. Whoever gets to put them in the video, I'm really sorry later. So the history. It's, you know, in German and also in Dutch, it's, we say flipper and not pinball, and say, okay, why? Well, it's the machines only came here in the 1950s when the flipper existed. Well, before it was a pinball, which was a board of pins, and but it exists a lot longer. So when you go back to the start, it starts at the 1800s, 1930s, more or less a French game, Bagatelle. It's a board with nails and you shoot up a little ball like playing pool, and then you, wherever it lands, and you can hit the bell and it goes ding and you get extra points. In 1931, they started asking money for it. So you would get a small ball and do the same thing with shooting the ball with a spring, but you still had to count the points yourself. People were cheating, so you had a tilt mechanism, which was, if you can see it over here, the little ball in the cup. If it got out of the cup, you had to tilt. They had to open the machine, put the ball back in the middle and slap you in the face and start again. So in 1935, Harry Williams, that's the same Williams as from all the pinball machines, He invented the more or less the current tilt design that's still in use. It's a weight on a stick, and when you shake it too hard, it makes a contact and the alarm bells go off, and it stopped working. You have the pop bumpers. They started in 1936, although the ones as we know them now will come later. And the first flippers as we know them come from 1947. Game called Humpty Dumpty. The flippers were not at the bottom. They were more or less everywhere on the playfield in all directions just to keep the ball up there. For some strange reason, this was a big hit, so people could play longer. The first classic flippers as we know them are from 1950. And the inlanes, outlanes, the lanes that can make you lose your ball, they come in still later. Active pop bumpers are in 48, and the famous drop target comes in 1962 in the final version that we have today. and electronics show up in 1977. So when people ask, okay, why does a pinball work like this? This has to be more efficient. You can do it differently. Well, no, there's you know, 80 years of research in it. So this works best for 80 years, 50 years, 40 years. So, and we haven't found anything better, so we don't change it. So computers meant the digital displays, which come in 91. And then in the late 90s, Bally Williams had two machines which used a CRT. You have Revenge from Mars here. I think you have two of them. They were short-lived because during the production of the second one, which was based on the fantastic first Star Wars movie, Episode 1, they stopped production and Williams said, okay, we stop pinball production right now and we shut everything out and that's it. Of course, the business didn't die and then it slept for a while and then in the early 2000s it got back and I think in 2013 you had Jersey Jack who put the first LCD in the pinball machines. A few years ago, Stern followed as well. You have some smaller production companies who also put LCDs in there to make it better to play with. So more firsts, if somebody wants to. Specifically, if you look at what you have over here, you have a firepower with the first lane switch, the light on top that they switch when you hit the flipper for your bonus multipliers. F-14 Tomcat was the first one with up kicker that kicks the ball upwards. Black Knight 2000 has the first wizard mode, the ransom mode. For some strange reason, these are all games by Steve Ritchie. So, I mentioned the outlanes and some terminology. So, this is your more or less basic setup. Flippers at the bottom, the two triangles, the slingshots at the side. And you have outlanes on the outside, inlanes on the inside, left and right. Etc. Now, before you want to say, if you want to know how to play a game, it's first of all, it's best to read the rules. There's in every pinball machine, there's a small card at the bottom which will explain to you, okay, you have to do this and this to get a multi-ball, this and this to get the jackpot, this and this to get extra balls, etc. Take your time and read it. Even when you have a ball waiting to shoot, just leave it there. Read it and say, okay, you need to hit target ABC, look on the playfield ABC, okay, then you more or less know where to begin and not just keep the ball in play. And when you're playing, first-time players will do a flip. They will flip at the same time and look like a strange baby seal when they flap like that. Don't do that. This will not help you. You have two brain halves. They can work independently, so you can control your left and your right hand individually. What I also see people doing is absolutely nothing. They see a ball coming down. It's lying on a dangerous spot, and they're like, ah! And they like, no. You can control the ball. You can control what's happening. You can control it the wrong way. You can also control it the right way. Controlling the right way is the important part of all of this. So basic control skills that I'll cover. Aiming, up push, cradle, bounce pass, roll pass, tip pass, life cap, drop stop. They're all terminology which don't matter. And as an example, I use the Addams Family because it's the most produced game worldwide. More or less 20,000 are made. And you have one here for the technicians. Your GI string at the top is out. Need to fix it. Sorry. So we'll start with the Addams Assembly and how it works. We'll get to that. First of all, if the ball is flying around on the playfield, you have no control. Rule number one is always to get control that you can decide where the ball is going, what you're going to, and for that. It's called a cradle. Just keep up your flipper, the ball will roll behind it and stay behind it on most of the machines. Some stretch machines have a hole there, don't do that. Because then the ball will of course drain and go away. If you feel really good during a multi-ball, you can even block a ball there and just keep playing around with the other one so to go for your jackpot. Ideally, on the Black Knight 2000, you can do this. On the left flipper, keep a ball. On the right flipper, play it upwards, go up, lower the drawbridge, go up the drawbridge, and get jackpot. It's really that easy. Or not. And when you have a ball in a cradle, you can, of course, aim, because it's lying there silent. You have it under control. And you can decide where you want it. So from a standstill, on Adam's family, on your left flipper, you have more or less four shots. You can go into the chair, up the ramp, you can go for the bookcase, or you can go into the swamp. And those are then things that you can slowly aim for. Now, should you miss, and the ball starts on the slingshots, go tick, 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 and up, you have a high chance of losing it. So a good method is that once you get to a slingshot, give it a slight push. If you know physics, the ball will lose energy, it will roll down, and you can catch it into a cradle and continue. Anyway, don't let the ball tick, tick, tick all the way to the top, because you will lose it. That's not a proper thing to do it. And some low-risk tricks that you can also try is the bounce pass, which means if the ball comes flying towards a flipper, you have to give it a little push, but don't flip up, and the ball will bounce over to the other side a lot slower, and you can again capture it with a cradle, or you can aim a bit better. On Adam's family, when it comes out of the chair, you can bounce off the left flipper, and it'll go a lot slower on the right flipper, and from there you have more control and you can aim for something new, or maybe cradle it for 5 seconds and take a mental break and see what you can do. A roll pass, for this you need to have some speed in your ball. You will have your flipper up, the ball will roll up the flipper, fly over the drain hole if it's going fast enough. So be sure that that's fast enough, and then you can go to the other side. On Adam's family, with some luck, when you come off the ramp into the wireframe from the right flipper, flip up your right flipper and it will bounce over to the left one, where you can then go back down and aim. Should you end up on the wrong side, so you want to aim for something on the left, but you're on the left flipper, you can transfer a ball from left to right with some timing. You have the ball up in the cradle, you let go, you immediately flip up again, and if done correctly, the ball will bounce off the rubber to the other side, where you can cradle it again. You can just practice going left and right, and left and right, and left and right, until you get the technique. Not every machine is the same. On some it doesn't work, on some it works a little bit too good. It depends on characteristics, on the height of the rubbers, how bouncy they are, how new they are, strength of the flippers, etc. But that's a very good technique to master, because you can you won't be stuck. Now, timing, some more difficult settings is the live catch. Basically, ball coming down, flip up at the moment the ball is at your flipper, and all the energy will be gone, and it will roll down, and you can quietly catch it and come to a cradle. On Adam's family, when it comes out of the swamp, you can normally catch it on your right flipper. I say normally because on this one it doesn't work. The setting inside is in such a way that the ball flies off in the wrong direction, and it's actually really hard to catch. There's also the drop stop. The same, but reversed. Your flipper is up, your ball comes flying down. You drop the flipper with the ball on it. You need to learn this. And then you can more or less control the ball. It will not stop the ball, so you will have to act quickly. You cannot take 5 second break and then see what happens. And you have a slap save. That's if the ball is coming down really hard, and you think if you've lost it, you have to slap one flipper before the other one. And with some luck or some epic skill, your ball will be nudged by one flipper into the other, and it will fly up again into the play field. You have very little control of where the ball will end up if you slap save, but at least you still have the ball in play, and you can try to gain control again and take it from there. Nudging is shaking the machine left and right. The side of the machine is usually coated with rubbers, which are bouncy, and if you slide it in the direction of the ball, you will lose energy. If you go into the ball, you will gain energy. So if you see the ball going for the out lane, you can try to shove the machine into the ball so it will get some extra energy and bounce away from the danger area. This looks really complicated to explain, but just try it. This is one of the things of doing nothing is a bad thing. So this is doing something, so you have nothing to lose. At least you can keep the ball in play and try to gain control and see what happens. On some machines, they have a little bouncy pin between the flippers. If you're really brave, you can try to bounce the ball on that one. Doesn't always work, sometimes works. I've also seen one of the Gottlieb, has a Gottlieb flippers on the side here, was it the X sector, has a big potion there with a big rubber, and I didn't know it was there. So the ball came point, and I said, okay, the ball is lost, and then whoops, went back up, like, oh look, there's a chill maneuver that I didn't even know about. An assembly doesn't have that, so watch out. Don't assume that there is a little pin, so always look up front if it's there or not. So let's combine now. Assume the ball is coming out of the swamp. You can do a live catch. You bring the ball to a stop. You aim to go up the ramp. The ball will come down again at the flipper. You put your flipper up, you perform a roll pass, and then you can backhand into the chair. Why backhanding? It's quite often a lot safer because there is less power on the flip on the flipper, on the ball. So if something goes wrong and you miss, you have more chance of saving it. And then you have to work the rules. As said, read the rules, see what's where. And on Addams Family, you can play on two different levels or both at the same time. You can play Dimension with all the mini missions, or you can go for the bookcase on top, which will get your multi-ball started. For Dimension, it's really easy to read. In a pinball machine, lights have three state. They're off, they're blinking, or they're on. Off means there's nothing, you can forget it. Blinking means you hear something to get, like, hi, I want your attention. And a light that's on is mean, okay, you have this, you don't really have to worry about it, but it's a status, so you know, okay, you have two balls locked, and the third one is blinking, so you know you can put the third ball into source to start your multi-ball. Also important is to get a skill shot. It's the first shot that you can do with your ball. If you can get it into a specific location, you will get extra points. On Adam's Family, it is the ting hole, where then it will come out of there and grab the ball. Take some practice to more or less feel how strong you have to pull the ball into the game. But in the end, you should be able to do it. And then, when you read the rules, every game has its specific details, its specific things that you can score points with. When you go for Addams Family, there is, on the display is a label called Ting with two stars on the end. Every time you go up the left ramp, you will add a letter to Ting. If you go through the loop, it'll add a star. And when you have the get ball to Ting or Ting multi-ball, your score will depend on how far a Ting and the stars have been progressed. In addition, another family, when you shoot with a small flipper on the left across the playfield into the swamp, you will get a five times swamp bonus, usually 5 million instead of 1 million when you hit it separately. And these are some small things that you can read from the rule set, so don't play around randomly. There's also some hidden bonuses in the game. There's a four-way combo that if you do four shots in a row, you will get extra points in Anno's Family. This is you go up the ramp. You go through the orbit in the pop-uppers up to the upper right flipper. You go up the ramp. Then you go into the swamp. Those four shots you can... That's the longest shot run that you can do with different shots in Anno's Family. If you do all those four, you get, I don't know, it's 5 million bonus. And it will say on screen, four-way combo. So all these things, having one move after the other, is a magical concept called flow. Flow is... the ball will always come down to your flippers through the metal bars, and you can continue to shoot it up and around and around and around and around in one big continuous move. The internet says that flow is popular. If you look at the internet pinball database, most of the pinball machines in the top five have really good what they call flow. As in, you can keep on combining shots, going around and around and around. Some very confusing examples on Star Trek. Theater of Magic, Monster Bash, and Medieval Madness. All of these shots will more or less bring the ball nicely back to you down, and you can keep on going and going and going and going and going. But we were talking about extra awards and not really about flow. So have some Easter eggs or extra hidden points that are always hidden in machines. But Anno's Family, it's called, one of them is called the Dirty Pool. So normally your bookcase on top is closed. Should you be able to drop a ball in there anyway by pure luck or skill, you will get a dirty pool and have a ball lock and some extra points. You're looking really hard. You're squinching your eyes, yes. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Everything is right, yes. It's also left, sometimes. So, and they had this dirty pool that if you go to attack from Mars, if you have a ball behind the barrier and then shoot it down the hole by hitting the barrier, you get the dirty pool as well. They copied the feature, and in Indiana Jones they actually made it part of the game, as they put in some plastic bounce posts that you can actually make the shot. Other Easter eggs are midnight multiballs on some of the later 90s Williams machines. If your clock would hit midnight, it would suddenly start midnight multiball. It's a hidden thing. They have also a hobby of hiding cows in all the displays. I've also noticed that you have some French machines here from a French importer. If you switch them on the birthday of the wife of the importer, it will say happy birthday and then the name of the wife. And I think Star Trek Next Generation actually has, if you push a certain magic combination on the flipper buttons while in attract mode, you will have a mini breakout game as well. So there's tons of stuff. I think even some years ago, by dumping and analyzing the ROM chips, they found a new hidden feature in one of the Indiana Jones pinball machines that nobody found in 20 years by playing it. It also caused some sneaky locks, so even when you don't have a ball lock active, you can still lock a ball. In Circus Voltaire, I don't think you have one, when you go up the ramp, and if it's slow enough, it can go down again. It'll actually give you an animation on the screen of a sneaky lock, a ball tipping by, as in, well done. Theater of Magic has a similar one. You have the box in the middle. If you go slow enough, the ball can drop inside the box in the back, and it will immediately give you a lock, and you don't have to go through the entire process of trying to lock the ball. So, who have I lost until now? Because it's 90 slides in about 25 minutes.
We're still here.
Everybody's here? Nobody died? Cool. So, when you're doing games with more than one player, sometimes you can cheat, abuse it a bit because of the limitations of the system. So, for instance, on a Black Knight, you can steal multi-balls, as in, if one player locks two balls for you, before you, you only have to lock one extra ball to get the multi-ball out. Later, games such as AdAssembly will compensate, or Funhouse, they will kick out a locked ball, so you can continue, but with the older lock systems, where it's all in one big box, they have to kick them all out so you can, you know, steal locked balls from somebody else. Should you be playing on Adam's Family, say you have two balls locked and somebody else gets the multi-ball and your balls are gone, it's really easy to lock them again. Either you take the skill shot and Ting will come out, pick up the ball and lock it, or you can shoot it very softly into the swamp. The game will actually say good thinking, and your ball is immediately relocked, and again you get the points. And I said earlier that aiming is important, but sometimes it's better not to aim, because something might be not in reach or a bit too dangerous. So if you go for Funhouse, you have Rudy on the top right. On the left is the mirror where that you need to shoot the ball in. From the left flipper, it's really hard or close impossible to hit in a straight line. So what you do is you have on the side the hot dog targets. If you shoot those targets, the ball will then bounce into the mirror. If you have a hot dog going, you have extra points as well. And there seems to be a warning, I don't know for what for. So, yes. So, as said, if you shoot from right to left to right, it's called a forehand, which puts a lot of force, a lot of power on the ball and on the flipper. So, if you miss the shot, the ball can come back really, really hard and impossible to control. If you backhand it, something on the left of the flipper, with the left flipper that you try to hit it, it's a lot slower, so it's a lot safer. This ball, if you miss the chair, will come down really hard and you will 80% lose it. If you do it from the left, it'll go a lot slower, and if you miss, it's easier to control. Should the ball be on the right, I've talked about the bounce pass, that you can flip the ball from one side up to the other. Just do a bounce pass. Just do a bounce pass. And there you go. Same thing for, this is white water. I don't think you have a white water here, so you cannot practice this. There are two little targets that you need to hit to lock the ball. If you shoot them directly, your ball will be gone. It's almost as it's designed for that. So the best thing is to shoot just next to it and touch it with the ball into some kind of hole. It will give you a lock, and with some luck, it's immediately there and ready for the next ball. This takes some practice. If it doesn't work for the first time, don't worry, keep on trying. In the end, I'm pretty sure you'll make it. And I'm gonna end with some illegal moves that will, if you do it in a game room or at somebody's house, it is their good right to kick you out. The first one is called the bang back. So when you lose the ball but to the side and it's rolling down the metal shield into the hole, if you flip up the flipper and then slam the machine in the front, you can have some energy in there that the ball will bounce back into play. Most if you have a machine, you can prevent this by putting the metal shield a bit up so that it does not touch the wood from the cabinet, and then this won't work. And as I said, when the ball comes straight down, you will lose it. Not always, but the technique is not always ideal. You put one flipper up and you slide the entire machine to the left, moving it 10-15 centimeters at the bottom. And because the ball goes in a straight line and goes faster, it will keep on having its velocity and direction, but the machine will move, so you will still catch the ball. Many competitions will disqualify you if you do this. So only in very last resort. If you do it fast enough, you will not get a tilt warning, because the weight will not start swinging. But in general, try not to, because over here they're all close to each other, you will damage the other machine, and the rider will get very angry at you and take pictures. So in the end, it's kind of you have to behave. I really like this one. So you see, don't put stuff on it, don't shake them too hard. Don't, when the ball is stuck, don't lift it up at the front to let it come free, etc. And if you're angry, shout at it and bang your head against the wall. No, I've seen people in competition finals, in anger, push a machine 1 meter back, and then they were disqualified. So that's it. I know this was really quickly, 113 slides. If there are any questions, you can ask them. But I think it's better that I'll just walk forward, or yeah, sure.
One of my favorite flippers is that he had one of the first slides he had, the wizard mode.
Okay, so question is, Black Knight 2000, what's the wizard mode? So a wizard mode is achieved by a pinball wizard. It's like a special final end game of everything. If you look at modern pinball today, you will have, when you have all the multi-balls completed with super jackpot, you have like a special multi-ball or whatever. That's your wizard mode. No, it's achievable. On the Black Knight 2000, it's you have the display, you have the ransom letters underneath. So, from memory, if you have your, you have on top, you have the bonus multiplier. So your bonus 2, 3, 4, 5 at the top. If you get the bonus multiplier, when you go up the ramp, there is a light ransom that's blinking on. If you lock a ball while that light is on, you will add a letter to ransom. When you have it complete, it will start ransom multiball, which gives you jackpot lit, unlimited balls, so balls that you lose will come back. It gives you a 5x bonus. Basically, it says everything is lit. That was the first game to do something like that. Another one is on Funhouse. When you complete the mirror, all the mirror mini games go flashing, and you have like a special mirror multiball and stuff in there. So that's the wizard mode. It's like the final end game. When you have reached wizard mode, you have completed it. In my Robocop pinball, that is getting a jackpot. Then that's it. I can start again. There's the software is out. So, any other questions? Well, if I should, question is what's my favorite of all time? Hard to say, but if I would have to sell them all, I would keep the Robocop. Yeah, because what Data East used back then, they had their arcade division, so they used the arcade sound chips in their pinballs, and the Robocop just has the most epic bass line. Once you get into the game for 5 minutes, that exists to the world. Not many rappers play pinball, or they would have sampled it a long time ago. Other nice ones. Basically what I have after all those years. So I like a Black Knight, like an F-14, because it's really brutal. It's like no mercy from the. The more recent ones, I really enjoyed the Batman Dark Knight from Stern. Later Williams, basically the layout that you have with Attack from Mars, Medieval Madness, Monster Bash, it's basically four times the same game with the same layout. But those are games that I like to play, but I wouldn't like to own them because it's always the same. Other questions? Alright, so thanks a lot. Those who were afraid to ask questions may see me afterwards. See you next time. Cheers.